and welcome to our online service today. It's wonderful to have you with us. Our service today is based upon the Book of Common Prayer, and I've put in some hymns that will hopefully be familiar to you. So please do enjoy the service. And we have our first hymn, Let Us With Talents and Tongues Enjoy. Ourselves before God, before we begin our service today. Let us pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Almighty God, unto whom all hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind, and with all thy strength. This is the first commandment, and the second is like, namely this, Thou shalt love thy neighbour as thyself. There is none other commandments greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us and incline our hearts to keep this law. And our collect for the Queen. Let us pray. Almighty God, whose kingdom is everlasting, and power infinite, have mercy upon the whole church, and so rule the heart of thy chosen servant Elizabeth, our queen and governor, that she, knowing whose minister she is, may above all things seek thy honour and glory, and that we and all her subjects, duly considering whose authority she hath, may faithfully serve, honour, and humbly obey her, in thee and for thee, according to thy blessed word and ordinance, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with thee and the Holy Ghost liveth and reigneth, ever one God, world without end. Amen. And let's just take a moment to gather our thoughts before we pray the collect for the second Sunday before Advent. Heavenly Father, whose blessed Son was revealed to destroy the works of the devil and to make us thy children of God and heirs of eternal life, grant that we, having this hope, may purify ourselves even as he is pure, that when he shall appear in power and great glory, we may be made like him in his eternal and glorious kingdom, where he is alive and reigns with you, in the unity of thy Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And so I hand over now to Debbie and Barbara for our readings.
Reading is taken from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 to 11. Now, concerning the times and seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say, there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them, as labour pains come upon a pregnant woman, and there will be no escape. But you, beloved, are not in the darkness, for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who are drunk, get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love. And for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Jesus said to his disciples, "The kingdom of heaven is as if a man, going on a journey, summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, 'Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours.' But his master replied, 'You wicked and lazy slave, You knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
So we come to the creed. And so let's declare our faith together. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Ghost of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again, according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of the Father. And he shall come again with glory to judge both the quick and the dead, whose kingdom shall have no end. And I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Lord and giver of life, who proceedeth from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe one Catholic and Apostolic Church, and I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. So I have pleasure of handing over now to Chris for our sermon.
Today's gospel ends with, "Throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. This isn't the God I know. This isn't the God I worship. This isn't the grace Jesus proclaims in every other way through his life, his healing and teaching and preaching and more. This isn't the love of God we see on the cross, and this isn't the hope that comes to us on the other side of the empty tomb. So how do I explain and make sense of this weeping and gnashing of teeth? I would like to make the suggestion that this parable is not what we call a kingdom parable. Like so many other parables of Jesus, this one doesn't begin with "the kingdom of heaven is like," or "the kingdom of heaven may be compared to." Jesus compares the kingdom of heaven to a net thrown into the sea, and a treasure hidden in the field, and a merchant in search of fine pearls, and all sorts of other things. But here, there is none of that. Instead, we hear something different. So I want us to think about the whole passage differently. The weeping and the gnashing of teeth may not have to have anything to do with the way of Jesus. The master in this story may not be God, the creator. The outer darkness may not be some kind of a threat to our eternal salvation. So what could it all mean? If Jesus isn't painting a picture of God's kingdom with this parable, then is he painting a picture of the world as it was for those who were listening to him? And as usual with Jesus' teaching, the world as it was is still very much like the world as it is today. Sadly then, as we look to find ourselves in the middle of it all, this understanding of the parable means that Jesus is protesting against the ways of the world around us and our misuse of the reliance on money. I think that the master in this story isn't the Lord. He's just a man. And he's a mean, selfish, abusive, greedy man at that. And that changes everything. Once we're allowed to consider him that way, that means that the slaves who please him aren't to be commended. They're to be questioned and pitied. Yes, they take his money and make more of it, but it is by unfair, unfaithful means. And everyone listening to in Jesus' day would have known that. The truth about society and the cultural norm in Jesus' day, especially for the faithful Jewish peasant, was that people weren't upwardly mobile capitalists like many in the Western world are today. They understood that anyone trying to get rich quick or to accumulate excessive amounts of cash was seen as messing with the equilibrium of the world around them. Whereas we are inclined to look at these first two slaves who doubled their master's money with admiration and a pat on the back. Jesus and his listeners would have looked at them with suspicion and judgment for likely defrauding someone or lending money with interest, like some sort of tax collector. And we know how people felt about tax collectors. In fact, the Old Testament scripture of Jesus' faith is full of warnings and prohibitions against storing up more than you can use, lending money for interest and the like. So these slaves who enter into the joy of their master weren't entering into the joy of God. They were entering into the joy of someone like Marlon Brando's godfather, this money-grabbing swindler who sends others to do his dirty work. This master who reaps where he doesn't sow and who gathers where he doesn't scatter seed. And remember, for their work in the end, these slaves were still slaves. After all, being put in charge of more dealings and dirty work than would have made the average law-abiding Jew cringe. And all of this means that the poor person who buried the money, who didn't invest wisely, who didn't make more of what he'd been given, who ends up cast into the outer darkness with the weeping and gnashing of teeth, is actually the hero of Jesus' story. This slave books the system, as it were. He's a revolutionary rebel. He might be seen as one of the 98%, to put things in 21st century language, protesting the elite powers that be. With fear and trembling, he stands up to the master and he refuses to play the money-grabbing mob boss game. He buries his money in the ground rather than try to make more of it by cheating others, by charging interest, or by growing wealth just as the sake of growing wealth, and again, with fear and trembling, because he knew what the result would be. He returns to the master the one talent with which he started, maybe because he simply didn't want to be that kind of wealthy. So what does this have to do with you and me and with our lives as followers of Jesus in the world as we know it today? If we understand the parable in this new way, we see Jesus not as painting a picture of God's kingdom where dirty deeds done dirt cheap are praised and rewarded in heaven, but we see this parable as an indictment of the way too much of the world was and is for so many. In that last slave, the one who gets thrown into the outer darkness, Jesus may even be painting a picture of just what's about to happen to him soon enough, when he refuses to play the game of the religious and political masters, when he himself is handed over to the outer darkness of the cross and crucified. And here then lies our hope and our invitation. We are invited, as ever, to live more like Jesus. When we talk and pray and invite one another to use our money for the good of God's church in the world, for the sake of the kingdom among us, we're doing nothing more and nothing less than challenging the ways of the world as we know it. We're standing up for generosity in the face of greed. We're choosing to be faithful instead of fearful with our resources. We're trying to figure out what is enough in our own lives so that we can help others have enough for themselves. This is hard work, holy work, but it's why faithful stewardship and being mindful about our money and using it as a tool for spiritual growth and worldly service are one of the greatest gifts of the church in the world and one of our greatest blessings as disciples. So as we make and share our offerings in the days to come, let's hope we see it all as a spiritual discipline that speaks truth to power. Yes, it will pay the mortgage and reduce our debt and serve lots of people in so many wonderful ways. But even aside from all of that, I hope we see our giving as a way of life that challenges the world's attempts to convince us that to have more means to be more. I hope our giving releases us from the master that money and greed and more want to be in our lives. And I trust that when we give with gratitude for what is already ours, that we will be filled with the joy of a different master, that we'll be filled with the joy of the master of grace and mercy and peace and new life, that is Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
And we now come to our time of prayer. Let us pray for the Church across the world, for its mission and ministry in these uncertain times, for all those whose lives have been affected by the coronavirus, either through illness, unemployment, anxiety, fear, or isolation. Let us pray for the leaders of all the nations, for universal human rights, justice, and an end to all forms of oppression. Let us pray for peace in the world. Let us pray for those who are sick or in any sort of need, for those who are in pain or discomfort, for those who live in fear. And let us pray for all those who have died, and for their friends and their families who grieve at this time. So, holding those intentions on our hearts, let us pray for the whole state of Christ's Church militant here on earth. Almighty and ever-living God, who by thy holy apostle hast taught us to make prayers and supplications, and to give thanks for all men, we humbly beseech thee most mercifully to receive these our prayers, which we offer unto thy divine majesty, beseeching thee to inspire continually the universal Church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all they that do confess thy holy name may agree in the truth of thy holy word, and live in unity and godly love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We beseech thee also to save and defend all Christian kings, princes, and governors, and especially thy servant Elizabeth, our Queen, that under her we may be godly and quietly governed, and grant unto her whole council, and to all that are put in authority under her, that they may truly and indifferently minister justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give grace, O Heavenly Father, to all bishops and curates, that they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and specially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and due reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succour all them who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we also bless thy holy name, for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, beseeching thee to give us grace so to follow their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen.
Thank you, Chris, for those insightful words. We come now to our time of confession and communion. Ye that do truly and earnestly repent you of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbours, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and prepare to meet with God in spiritual communion, and make your humble confession to Almighty God, meekly kneeling upon your knees. We say together, Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against thy divine majesty, and provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us, we do earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. The burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may hear ever after, serve and please thee in newness of life, to the honour and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who of his great mercy hath promised forgiveness of sins to all them with hearty repentance and true faith, turn unto him. Have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what comfortable words our Saviour Christ saith unto all that truly turn to him. Come unto me, all that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul saith. This is a true saying, and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John saith. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins. And so we come to our spiritual communion. Whither shall I go from thy spirit? Or whither shall I flee from thy presence? If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me. Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify thy glorious name, evermore praising thee and saying, holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of thy glory. Glory be to thee, O Lord Most High. Amen. In union, O Lord, with the faithful, at every altar of thy church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, I desire to offer thee praise and thanksgiving. I present to thee my soul and body, with the earnest wish that may always be united to thee. And since I cannot now receive thee sacramentally, I beseech thee to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to thee, and embrace thee with all the affections of my soul. Let nothing ever separate thee from me. May I live and die in thy love. Amen. Spend a few moments now in meditation upon the fact that God so loved you that he sent his only begotten Son into the world for you. The spiritual communion will come to an end with the words of the Lord's Prayer.
Christus, 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 Christ
Let us pray with confidence as our Father has taught us. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them that trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. We pray together. O Lord and Heavenly Father, we, thy humble servants, entirely desire thy fatherly goodness, mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant that by the merits and death of thy Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy and lively sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee that all we who are partakers of the spiritual communion may be fulfilled with thy grace and heavenly benediction. And although we be unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits but pardoning our offences, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom in the unity of the Holy Ghost all honour and glory be to thee, O Father Almighty, world without end. Amen. And we say the words of the Gloria together. Glory be to God on high, and in earth peace, goodwill towards men. We praise thee, we bless thee, we worship thee, we glorify thee. We give thanks to thee for thy great glory, O Lord God, Heavenly King, God the Father Almighty. O Lord, the only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. O Lord God, Lamb of God, Son of the Father, that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takest away the sins of the world, have mercy upon us. Thou that takest away the sins of the world, receive our prayer. Thou that sittest at the right hand of God the Father, have mercy upon us. For thou only art holy, thou only art the Lord. Thou only, O Christ, with the Holy Ghost, art most high, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Well, I hope you've enjoyed the service with us today. It's been wonderful to have you here. Just a couple of notices before we go. If you are knitting angels for the children for Christmas, we need to have them in to Kerry or Reverend Debbie by the 10th of December at the latest. So get knitting. Couple of dates that we are available for individual prayer at our churches. On Mondays and Fridays between 11 and 12 at Holy Trinity Rockwood Iron Wood. Between 5 and 6 p.m. on Tuesdays at St. Peter's. And 6 and 7 on Thursdays at Holy Trinity Oakengates. This is for private prayer only. There are further information on your newsletter. So please do come along and take some time in private prayer. And before we go, I'd like to pray God's blessing upon you all. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. do enjoy our final hymns before you finish today. See you again soon. Bye.
Of a broken heart, Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring to so faithful a friend, to so loving a King? Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of your name for the things you have done? All my words could not tell, not even in part.
Lord, receive the sacrifice of a broken heart.